Pnawn da pawb a chroeso ar ran Llyfrgelloedd Sir Ddinbych. Lois ydw i o Llyfrgell Rhuthun, so good afternoon everyone. I'm Lois and on behalf of Denbighshire Libraries, I'm so pleased to welcome you to this special event with not one, but two of our favourite illustrators, Jackie Morris and Kathy Fisher. You'll have seen their work in some of our favourite stories like The Pond, The New Girl, The Lost Words, Tell Me a Dragon and The Snow Leopard. So the Winter of Wellbeing campaign, it's been such a fabulous celebration at such an important time in our lives when we need to think about our wellbeing more than ever. We've been learning how stories can help us escape, relax and feel good, how they can help us understand the world and each other better and also help us understand our feelings too. We know that art adds magic to books, taking us to completely new worlds. And we know that creating art can make us feel good too. So we love the title of this talk, which is Express Yourself. And we can't wait to hear more about how Jackie and Kathy create magic for us as they draw and paint. I'm gonna pass it over to Jackie and Kathy. So let's all give them a very big wave.
So hello everybody, thank you for watching us. It is the most bizarre thing to be sitting in my studio, which is in a very small house right on the edge of Wales, talking to invisible people, rather than being in a school hall talking to you. So what are we talking about? The Winter of Wellbeing has been a bit of a struggle, but the wonderful thing is that we're moving now towards spring. When you do art for a living, not a hobby, it can be really difficult. People use drawing as a way to escape, but when it's your work, that's hard. Yesterday, I was having such a struggle with a painting, and I went out in the end. I just went out for a walk. It's very beautiful here. Wales is an amazing country. And as I was coming back from my walk down the beach, I looked up in the sky and there were swallows. And that was just so early to see swallows and so beautiful to see them. Such a heart lift. Now, I'm told that you've maybe been asked to have pencils and paper with you, and we were told to set you tasks. But Kathy and I are not people who usually do what we're asked to do.
No, we can be a bit disobedient. And I find it very difficult. If someone says to me, get a pencil and paper out and do me a drawing, I've always, all my life, found that difficult as much as I love drawing. So performing for someone, I find quite difficult. Or the expectations of what someone might want to see, I find difficult.
So yeah.
So I would suggest if you want to draw whatever you feel like. Doodle, scribble, make marks.
So doodle while we're talking or listen to us and watch. I can do both. I usually, when I have meetings with publishers, I have a very bad habit of drawing my way through them because images are how I think. I don't always think in words, sometimes I think in images. And it looks always like I'm kind of fidgeting. I used to get told off at school for drawing and for dreaming. Now I get paid to do both of those things, which is rather nice.
Nice.
So both Kath and myself, we love drawing. We love mark making on paper, would you say?
I do.
What's your favourite? Do you prefer drawing or painting?
Well, I find it really difficult to actually separate them. And I know they are two different things, but I draw and I paint in at the same time. So a lot of my drawings are paintings and drawings and paintings and drawings, if that makes sense.
But you also,
I use lots of different media. Yeah. So I use pencil and crayon and paint and ink and pastel. Jackie paints with watercolor, like a magician?
I start drawing though. I usually, more now than I used to, I will draw first in a sketchbook. And I've got sketchbooks here to show you. These are some that I've had for a long time. And this one has odd little pictures in. Just, you know, I'm not really thinking here about what a finished thing will look like. I'm just playing with pages. There's a lot of space in them sometimes. This sketchbook is from, let me just have a look, 2002, long time wow. ago. Yeah. I fill the page more these days. These are pictures that maybe one day they will be paintings. This is when I didn't have any ideas in my head. But I have a small friend who travels places with me, this little bear. And when I get stuck for anything else to draw, I start drawing my bear. And quite often he has a cup of tea because he likes tea. And now and again, an umbrella because...
Because it rains a lot?
Well, no, just for the sunshade, really, okay. You know? And also because once upon a time when I was in Glasgow, I had an umbrella, but I left it with some bears. So I just always try and imagine what they might be doing.
They still got the umbrella?
They still got the umbrella, yeah. Good. There were three of them, three bears in Scotland, brown ones they were though. So I try and work out what they might be doing. Those two are obviously having quite a chat. Can you see that one? And some of these will become paintings. One of them might become a story. I have this feeling. Somebody said that my bear looked as if it had lost its piano.
Oh, yeah.
But I think she's lost her sewing machine. And she's making a quilt. And the quilt is stitched with pictures. Because you can draw with stitching as
yeah,
well, can't you?
Definitely.
So what she's doing is she's making a quilt for a child to keep a child warm. And people look at the Arctic and the Antarctic. The polar bears live in the Arctic, don't they?
They do.
And they think that it's a wild wilderness where nothing lives apart from polar bears. But there are so many different creatures there and flowers. And she's stitching into this quilt all the life that lives in this white landscape. So one day, maybe... that's going to become a book.
I was going to say, you've just written another book.
Well,
she just writes.
It'll be a book without any words in, though, I think. Mm-hmm. I just want her to be just stitching and stitching. And oh, maybe not. I don't know. I haven't really thought it through yet. But I also like the idea of a polar bear using a sewing machine.
The drawing is, isn't it? Not just a pencil and not just paper.
Mm.
You can draw in the sand with your finger. You can draw with a sewing machine, a needle and thread. You can draw with a stick.
I want to draw with a chisel.
With clay,
on stone.
On stone.
Mm-hmm. And a paintbrush. I love the way, I love watching Kath paint because she draws very much with the colours of the paintbrush as well. So, yeah, layers, building up in layers.
Yeah, I guess that's why I get confused between drawing and painting.
Yeah, overdrawing.
I mean, my sketchbook, it's got quite a lot of painting, and that's just the first page,
yeah,
which was
beautiful
in a garden. And then I had to go, and also I paint the colors that I have in my palette so I can remember what color they are when I, because they often don't look the same in your paint box,
yeah,
until you put water on them,
yeah. This is a painting. This is from when Kath was stuck in a room in Australia.
I had to go to Australia. And I had to isolate because of COVID. And I got stuck in a room in a hotel with no window. Well, a window, but couldn't open. And that was my view, little house. So while I was there to keep me happy, because yeah. It was very difficult being on your own for 10 days. And some of these drawings are a bit dark. You see, they're painterly, but they were drawing. And they're doodles, really.
But you were also thinking, and when you were painting. Doing these, about a book that we're working on together.
So this was
The Panda's Child.
This was thinking. This was a mother and child asleep. In fact, I might have it upside down.
Beautiful.
Oh, I did.
Really beautiful.
And this book this is my sketchbook and it's just my thinking book. So I write lists, I draw what I think the next picture might be. And often, you know, I have a drawing, I've made a decision, then I start the picture for the book and it becomes something completely different.
Oh, move that this way a bit, that's beautiful, that little cricket.
It's a little cricket.
This way. The cricket in the green, beautiful.
Oh, that cricket there. Yeah.
So did you always draw?
Yeah, always, because I was a child of nine and I was number four.
Okay. And is that what they called you?
My parents did number us. A bit like the Von Trapp family, which you won't know about because you're too young, Sound of Music. But my drawing for me was my escape. Mm. And it was solitary. And it was my way of going into my own world and imagination and drawing things that what I loved about it, because I wasn't doing it for anyone to see. I loved that I could draw something that made me understand my feelings. And I think I've said this previously. I was once drawing a chimpanzee when I was about six or seven. And for the first time, I could feel it. I could feel it as real. I could feel it as alive. And it gave me such a thrill. That kind of set me up almost forever. Then everything I do has to have feeling, for me, not necessarily for anyone else, but if somebody can feel that back, then I am ecstatically happy.
Yeah.
Because you're expressing something that's often very difficult to talk about.
Mm.
And so that's what I love drawing.
So I've been kind of learning my whole life why I do what I do. I started wanting to be an artist when I was six and I watched my dad drawing a bird, and I wanted to be able to do that alchemy. I wanted to take a pencil and make a bird land on a piece of paper using the pencil. And that's what I've been striving for ever since. And once I was asked by a child, you know, how do you feel after you've finished drawing? And or how do you feel when you're drawing? And the thing is, when I am drawing, well, when I finished a drawing, I usually have a feeling of disappointment with my work because I've had an image inside my mind, in your mind's eye, and I've tried to pull that out and put it onto paper. And it never comes out in the way that I want it to. And I have this kind of feeling of disappointment. So it took me a long time to work out why then I would carry on.
Mm.
And it is because when I am actually drawing, when I'm painting, when I'm thinking about the work, when I'm making it, it gives me an incredible sense of peace of mind and being complete, really. It's very it's just you and the space between your head and the paper that you're working on, having this conversation, this constant conversation, you know, do I do this, what happens if I do that, press harder, is that the right shape, if I change it here, what happens then, constant questions and answers. And that's the part that I love. If I don't do it for a while, because, you know, being a grown up is like, oh, and so much stuff gets in the way of being able to converse with paper, then it's not good for my health, for my mental health. I have to paint. It's like a medicine in a way. And also this conversation with paper, it works another way as well, which is that I love to read. I absolutely love that magic alchemy of reading that takes 26 letters of an alphabet and when you're reading a book, that's all that's there, and pictures if you're really lucky. But it builds worlds inside your head, doesn't it? And you find friends in books. And
And it was pictures that got me reading. I think I was probably quite a slow reader. I can't really remember.
I was really slow. I didn't get it at all. It was pictures.
Yeah. So I was always more interested in the pictures in a book.
Yeah. Still am. So, really.
Yeah, I am too.
Truth be told.
I always look at pictures first. Yeah. So I think the pictures led me into then a love of reading, of stories, of words, because stories, your imagination, things you make up, things you read that someone else has made up, carry you into a place, carry you away, sometimes from daily troubles in life. And that moment just gives you a breath of fresh air, a breathing space, a space. Yeah. And space, those spaces are very important in our lives.
Yeah.
To have moments of
peace and calm.
Yeah,
this is my first book that I ever made, and when I made this one, if you can see that the color is very flat, it's very simple, and the pencil line is very dominant. It's quite hard looking at this now. I know that it's nearly 30 years old, and I couldn't really paint when I did this, so I drew and then I filled in with color washes. This, I think, is my second book, and I made this one using pencil crayons. The text is absolutely beautiful. It's by a lady called Caroline Pitcher, and it's about some children who build a whale out of snow.
I haven't seen this book.
I'll let you read it later. Might even read it to you. It's drawn. There is no painting here. I haven't done another book like it, I think. I guess I was very influenced by Raymond Briggs' Snowman, because he did a beautiful book called The Bear, which is a really big book, and it's all done in colour pencils. Really, really lovely. So I was abandoning paint, but I did go back to paint. And
I guess that's why I use both paint and pencil, Chris.
Yeah,
I like
this one's all painted. This is The Lost Words, but it's actually lost its title. Look on the cover. Aha. Can you show? New Girl is right on the bottom of that pile of books. And this is one that I watched Kathy making. It was a wonderful experience for me. We both got stuck in my house during lockdown, and so Kathy actually did all the work for this book next door. And I got to watch somebody else work, which was quite a lesson for me.
Yeah. And this is a lovely, beautiful story about the grace of a small child who wasn't being welcomed. And she had this way of touching all the children in her class by making them aware of beauty, to change their way of treating her. So she was a new girl that came to school from another country, looked and smelt differently, her food was different. And the children...
This is beautiful, because this shows, this is one when she was... quite, you can see how alone she is in this, and Kathy used colour to kind of emphasise the sadness of this, with the other children picking on her.
And the interesting thing about drawing is it always, I'm old, and it goes, and I've been drawing for 60 years, and it always comes right back. So that drawing that Jackie's just shown you of the big wide steps might seem terribly, terribly wide, but I realised after I'd drawn it that actually what I'd drawn was my own primary school steps. And to me, when I was little, those steps were very wide, they were very big, they were very scary.
Maybe I didn't.
And so
and very bleak. But then we move into colour. When she draws by folding paper, doesn't she? She makes
origami flowers
and just leaves them as gifts for people. So that's where the colour comes back in. And then you can see she has a friend now.
She leaves them around the class, and then she's off school for a while, and they all miss the flowers and realise that she's made them. When she comes back, she gets them all to teach her.
And I love the end papers of this book, which are just colour and a gift. Beautiful. Very
and
beautiful.
And that book's been translated into Welsh, which is good.
Yeah, The Lost Words as well, by Mirera Topwood.
Yeah.
Amazing.
And going back to talking about having emotions, feelings that are difficult to describe, The Pond, written by Nicola Davies, as The New Girl was too, is a very sad story because the dad dies almost at the beginning of the book. And at the time I was illustrating this, a dear friend of mine was also very ill. And so there's a page in particular, which is probably difficult to see because it's quite dark.
Well, that's good. You can see that. Yeah.
Where in here, there's a hole and all the grief is going into the hole. And when I was painting it, I just focused and put all my sadness into that hole. It helped. It makes you find a place to put whenever you're not feeling great.
Yeah. And it is hard, you know, I don't know whether you get this, but I don't know how many paintings I've done, thousands probably. But when you're faced with a blank piece of paper, and you've got to start another drawing, it's always difficult,
yeah,
isn't it?
Always.
Still, and it is, that is,
I've got
scary.
One next door waiting.
Fear of white paper.
Yeah,
it's yeah.
I have a love and a fear of it because I love the white paper and the promise it has and what might go on it, because you never really know, which is another
my favorite sketchbooks are empty sketchbooks. They're because they're so full of promise. But I keep all my sketchbooks and I go back through them sometimes.
Yeah.
I like these little ones at the moment. This is a folding one, and it kind of, little painting. It folds out, this one. Oh, I don't know whether I can do it. So I've been practicing drawing foxes because I have to paint them.
Look at those beauties.
Fox after fox after fox. Doing different things. These are so, I love these.
They're brilliant.
They're
brilliant.
Great.
Yeah.
I've got the whole back of that one as well. Start working on the back. Strange little things. Yeah. So we've got a little bit of time before questions. Is there anything else that you can think of? There's no right or wrong.
There's no right or wrong in drawing. And the other thing that used to confuse me when I was young was people would say, so and so is really good at drawing because that person can draw a house that looks just like a house, or that person can draw a dog that looks just like a dog. But to me, that doesn't matter. It doesn't have to look like anything. What matters is what has come from you in here, that you have expressed with all your truth.
But it is okay just to doodle for
yourself. So that could be just a doodle. And when I'm talking on the phone or something, my doodles are literally just patterns. I just doodle shapes, patterns. I actually don't draw things. And sometimes I look back at those doodles and I think, whoa, I was in a bad mood that day. I was quite happy that day. So
sometimes that's where my best ideas for paintings come from, because I've only got half a brain on it.
Yeah, not really.
Because you can, there's this thing about concentrating so hard sometimes that you get in your own way.
Yeah.
And sometimes when you've only got, it's like juggling.
Yeah.
When you learn to juggle, you can only do it when you kind of let go of everything.
You have to stop thinking.
So sometimes when I'm on the phone and I'm just doodling, and something will just just like just a and it's there. That's like I can't do that thing where you have pencil and paper, somebody says sit down, now you've got half an hour to draw.
Yeah.
I need to go for a walk.
Yeah.
I need to carry an idea with me.
Yeah.
And then almost be not thinking about it. And that's the space where it slides in, really, the idea. Sometimes it works.
And it's nice to just take a pencil or anything. That's
my pencil. She's got
for a walk, literally just walk it round a paper, do whatever you like with it. Do not feel you have to draw.
And then see shapes and pictures.
Yeah, and then you find animals and creatures and shapes. And
I'm just going to go like that because I love that picture. Gorgeous. Gorgeous.
But I've been doing it a long, long time and I still feel sometimes, oh, that's not good enough, that's not good enough.
Yeah, it's never good enough.
But then you look back at it later and you think, actually,
it was all right. It's all right, really. Sometimes what I used to do when I worked on the ground floor was I'd go outside and look in through the window.
The ground floor of this house, downstairs.
Yeah, so I'd get a mirror.
A mirror's good.
Yeah. See it differently.
Or sometimes you take a photograph of it and you see it little on your, you know, on the phone or something, and then you...
It always looks better little. Yeah. Squint at it. Yeah.
Brilliant. Thank you so much. I'm going to jump back in now because I think we are ready for some questions. But thank you. That was really lovely to listen to. Hi, everyone. My name's Zoe and I work at the Reading Agency. We've been very lucky to be hosting this event alongside Denbighshire Libraries. So I'm going to be asking Kathy and Jackie a few of your questions. So if any more questions pop into your head, please do put them in the chat box. We've got a little while for questions, so we'll try and answer as many as we can. But I've got the first question here, which is from Isgul Bothin School. I hope I've pronounced that correctly. And their first question is, how did you both learn to be illustrators? How did it all start?
Ooh, well, I'm still learning. We both went to college. But you didn't do illustration,
No, I
did
didn't.
You?
I went to art school and I studied fashion design, clothes design.
But you must have had to draw.
Yeah, and the reason I did that was I did actually want to be an artist, always. But I thought, I was told you can't make any money.
Being an artist.
I started as fashion design and then slowly, my career took off as an illustrator.
Mm. And I went to art college and came out not really knowing how to illustrate still. And I've been learning ever since. And one of the best ways to learn anything is by doing it, really.
Practice.
Yeah, practice, doing it over and over and over again.
Great, thank you. We have another question, which is, are there any books that haven't been illustrated that you would love to create an illustrated edition for?
Oh my goodness.
Oh, many.
God.
I used to want to do illustrations for Angela Carter books, which are not, they're books for grown-ups, really. At one time, I really wanted to do the Amber Spyglass. No, not the Amber Spyglass. The Northern Lights.
Oh yeah.
But but that's fine. They've been done by so many people now. I don't know. I do. When I read in a very visual way. So I'm kind of seeing pictures. There's a book called The Night Circus, which is just and also. The Starless Sea.
Piranesi,
beautiful book.
I actually really, really want to see adult books illustrated.
Because
I don't think illustrated books should be for any age. I think they should be for all ages.
Yeah, very much so.
That's brilliant. Thank you. I personally, obviously a bit too old for the people watching, but I also love Angela Carter. So maybe that's one that the kids can explore in a few years. Brilliant. So we have another question here from Pentwymore School. Again, I hope I've pronounced that correctly. And they have asked, what inspires you?
Ooh.
everything word.
Word. Well, when it comes to, for me, when it comes to us illustrating a book, and at the moment I'm illustrating one of Jackie's stories, well, that's a total inspiration. The story itself is a huge inspiration, and working with her next door is a huge inspiration. Her cups of tea inspire me.
Lots of cups of tea. walking is one thing. Yesterday, seeing swallows, just want to paint swallows now.
Music inspires me.
Mm-hmm.
So words, music, nature.
I'm very lucky at the moment. I'm working on a book with Robert McFarlane, who wrote The Lost Words, and it's a book of birds, and we write to each other most days about birds, and he's working on nests at the moment. So it's that I want to try and imagine what it's like to be a tiny bird in a nest, and what that feels like.
Crazy.
When you sit on eggs, and can you do the birds, mother birds, talk to the eggs or sing to them when they're incubating, when they're growing? Feel that warmth of being in that space. And so it depends what you're working on. I've never been like Kath was saying, there's a myth, which was when I was a child, it was the same thing, which is you can't make a living as an artist. That's not why people paint. For me, art is a form of prayer. It's a form of worship. And my cathedral is the wild. And that is what I like to work at, really. So that's my inspiration, I suppose.
Yeah. And for me, mine is, if I can get some feeling into a picture that a person reading, looking at it, can either get the feeling, same feeling back, or their own emotions that touch them and make some kind of connection between their heart and their brain, then that's my inspiration, I feel.
I also like to use my works. Children are amazing. You are amazing. You're so full of wonder and questions. And when I made The Lost Words, it was to give you a tool that you could take to your parents, to re-enchant your parents with the wonder of the wild world. Mm. So that's kind of, that's inspiration and conclusion, I suppose. Mm.
Lovely, thank you. That's really nice. So you've spoken a bit about birds and foxes, and then half my primary school has asked, what's your favourite animals to draw? And then maybe I'd ask, what are your least favourite animals to draw?
Can I do the least favourite?
Yeah.
Human beings, not my favourite things. I think individually we can be amazing, but collectively we have such an ability to be destructive. And we're very much kind of our ego about our place in the world, and is just astonishing. I'm not very good at drawing people. I don't like looking at them that much, but I love animals.
Yeah.
And yeah, you're all right. Okay, you're fine. You're creative. You're not destructive. It's, I cannot understand a mentality that is destructive. I can only understand creativity, it's such a hard thing to get past. I love bears. Anyone who knows my work will know that I love bears, leopards, tigers, but I also love the small birds in my garden, their bright eyes and their music. Trees, very difficult creatures to draw. And I need to learn how to do that.
But I have another way of thinking when it comes to drawing any animal, anything, any object, creature, is to actually not think of if, for example, you're drawing a person, not think of a hand as a hand, as the shape of the hand as we remember it in here, but to think of the patterns it makes, to think of the shapes that are in between it, to not think of it as, oh God, I can't draw feet, but I can draw hands.
Can't draw faces, but
I can draw chimpanzees. It doesn't really, to me, make sense, because you're just drawing shapes and tones and patterns and colours and putting in the emotion. And then it comes. And it doesn't matter how abstract it is.
You're so much better at drawing people than me, though.
I quite like drawing people.
Yeah. See, I don't. Yeah.
But I, at the moment, I'm drawing elephants, camels.
Small boy.
Ah, so some slightly wilder animals. That sounds great. Thank you. So this question is for Jackie, and it's so you've illustrated books written by other people and also your own stories, but which do you prefer doing?
What I prefer most of all is writing for other people to illustrate.
I love this book.
This is Mrs. Noah's Song, and this is, nobody else has seen this. It's not even published properly yet, so this is what they call... this is an advanced copy. This is the third book in a series about Mrs. Noah, and it's illustrated by James Mayhew. And I'll read you the first page. I love writing. I really do love writing. And it's an amazing thing when an illustrator takes your words and puts flesh onto the bones of them. So my words for this. First page. Mrs. Noah sang as she sewed, and she sowed seeds, and she sewed clothes. She loved the musical sound of her old sewing machine. She loved to sing. And then James has taken that and made this beautiful picture.
Beautiful.
So that is the most amazing thing. Yes. And at the moment, Kathy is illustrating the panda's child, and seeing that come to life is gorgeous. Look at this. Look at the tenderness in that. Isn't that gorgeous?
Beautiful. Just beautiful.
Lovely. So this is a book about music, and about listening, because all music is about listening. And it's about birds as well. So that's my favourite, is to write for other people to illustrate.
That's fantastic. Yeah, it must be quite cool seeing how somebody takes your words and turns them into pictures, and how they imagine them on the page.
Yeah. And it's a very different thing, because I actually draw words. I everything that I write, even if it's a long book, I write with a pen or pencil. So that's just like drawing words. But if I'm writing for somebody else to illustrate, then I don't imagine what the pictures will be like, because that's not my job. And I don't want to, I never tell an illustrator what they should draw, because that's their job.
Yeah, brilliant. Thank you. So we have another question from Isgul Bothin, and they've asked, what tools do you use to illustrate?
Tools.
Pencil,
paintbrush, paint. I use pencil crayons. I use pastels. I use ink. Paper. Good paper.
Yeah. Heavy. Are you smooth paper?
I use smoothish.
Yeah, mine is really smooth.
It's called hot press.
Yeah, mine's hot pressed. Yeah, but only actually, no, it's different, because the Lost Words, because it's very detailed, that was watercolour. So I'd start by drawing with watercolour, and then gold leaf, and that was hot pressed. But now I use some rough paper as well when I'm working very loosely with paint.
What does hot pressed mean?
Hot pressed is, it's two different ways of making the paper. The hot press makes it smoother, and cold pressed gives it that texture, that kind of rough watercolour texture. So it's almost, it's got a tooth to the paper, so it snags at the brush. And you can't be so detailed with cold pressed paper.
It's a looser, and really good for watercolour.
I use one that's made by a company called Two Rivers, so it's actually handmade paper, and made in England in a place called Watchit. And that's for when I do really loose painting.
And you have to stretch the paper, because as you probably all realise, when you're drawing and you put water on paper, it crinkles up. So we stretch it on a board, and that prevents it from crinkling up.
But I don't know. Can you see the texture on this? There we go.
You can see the edges.
So that's a bit of the cold pressed paper. I haven't got hot pressed to hand, but it's much smoother. Other people, what else do people illustrate with?
Well, whatever, I've illustrated with clay,
whatever works,
and sticks,
yeah,
and
feathers,
and
I paint with feathers sometimes,
seaweed ink, all sorts
of oak gall ink I've been using. That's nice. I love oak gall ink because it's made by a wasp, a tree, and a person, and I love that kind of coming together of the natural world.
Yeah, that's lovely. So really using nature in the art as well.
Yeah. Well, don't forget we're nature as well, so it is, you know,
exactly. Yeah. All working together. Yeah. Lovely. I think we have time for one last question before we end. So if you could both just maybe tell me what your favourite illustrated book was when you were younger, when you were a child.
Right, well, the one that comes four to my head first of all probably are the flower fairies, the field fairies, and I can't remember the illustrator's name.
Cecily May Beaton,
yeah,
was it
possibly? And they were a series of books, little ones like this, of flowers, plants, and they had little elves and fairies and creatures in them, and fruits, and I just loved them, and they just carried me into a place of,
you know what,
calm and peace.
I didn't like them.
Oh, I love that. It's really interesting how one person will love one, yeah, something, and the other person won't love,
yeah,
another.
No, I was just looking, my favorite was a book called The Tiger Voyage by Nicola Bailey.
Oh yeah.
And it was written by Richard Adams.
Yeah.
And the story actually wasn't that good, but the paintings, I really love the paintings. And now I really love Sean Tan, yeah, who is one of the best of us. And he paints, I think he must use oil paints, but he draws.
He uses everything, but those are, yeah, oil paints in that book.
And it's just, he's just brilliant. He did a whole book of drawings, which is called The Arrival.
Arrivals.
He's quite wonderful. And a book called The Red Tree, which is about not being very happy. I think grown-ups have this thing about just expecting children to be happy, and they forget that they once were children, and sometimes you're happy and sometimes you're sad. And The Red Tree is a wonderful book for exploring how it is okay to have those feelings. But when I was a child and I was not happy and I was confused by the world of grown-ups, still am, I would draw.
Me too.
Brilliant. Thank you so much for those recommendations. I think that brings us to end. So I'm going to hand back to Lois Jones now.
Wow, brilliant. Well, thank you very much. Diolch yn fawr iawn. What a lovely way to spend a Tuesday afternoon. Thank you, Jackie and Kathy, so much for coming into our homes and classroom today and sharing your world with us. It's brilliant and fascinating. And I think everyone is going to go home now to draw or paint or even doodle. I have my little doodle.
Yay! Good on you.
I did as well. I did a picture of a swallow, a little one.
Oh, brilliant. There we go. Lovely. And thank you as well to all the kids that joined us today. And to remember as well that for the Winter of Wellbeing campaign, there's lots of different activities and events going on. And if you ask your teacher or a family member, they'll take you to the website so you can see what's going on. And yeah, all the books as well by Jackie and Kathy are available at your local libraries. So you can pop in, you can borrow them, and we're very excited to see you all very soon. But until then, enjoy the rest of your day.
Yeah. Thank you, everybody.
Bye-bye. Bye.